Creo que ya podemos empezar. Entonces, Bernardo, tú lo presentas.
Sí. Well, I have the pleasure of introducing Professor Gaspar Galaz as today's speaker. Professor Galaz studied undergraduate physics at the University of Chile, where he also earned his master's degree in astronomy. And then he moved to the University of Paris, where he got his PhD in astrophysics. He also got a postdoctoral position at Carnegie, and since 2001, he is a professor at Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile, where he is still now the director of the Instituto of Astrophysics, at least for a few more hours, as they have already elected a new director. His primary research interests are the stellar and gaseous content in galaxies, optical and near-infrared extragalactic astronomy, statistical properties of the galaxy distribution, the large-scale structure of the universe, and he has made fundamental contributions to our understanding of low-surface brightness galaxies, a topic he has chosen to address today with his talk entitled Open Questions on Low-Surface Brightness Galaxies. So, Gaspar, please go ahead. And thanks for being here with us today.
Thanks to you for the presentation, the introduction. Yes, so thanks for the invitation to this colloquium in this new era of scientific talks, right, all around the world using Zoom. So I will talk today about a subject that has been around for a while. In fact, the science of low surface brightness galaxies is not new. It's very old. It's from the 70s, perhaps, or even before, when astronomers realized that, in fact, what you see in the sky is not all you have, apart from dark matter, but the brightness of the objects in the sky is hindered by many phenomena that are very badly understood at that time, now much better. And so this is a field in which there has been few people at the beginning, a little more after the 10 years, and then when the difficulties, especially the observational difficulties, start to arise, and people realize that it's very difficult to have good data on these galaxies, many people escape. That's my personal view on that. In the 90s, many people escape, and then with the advent of big telescopes and other useful tools, many people start to populate this field of study, in particular with the advent of the rediscovery of ultra-diffuse galaxies by Van Dokkum, something that has been discovered by Sandage early in the 80s. The interest of low-surface brightness galaxies increased, right? So now it's a field that is more and more populated with people, right? So this is the outline of my talk. I will start with definitions and some previous words, the relevance of this field in astronomy, some examples of LSBs, and some personally biased open question interesting to focus in this talk. And finally, I will conclude with the conclusions. So some previous words regarding this field. I remember a sentence that I heard in Las Campanas, where I was postdocs at the end of the 90s. Bill Kunkel always says that in Spanish, para conocer bien un estanque y disfrutarlo más, es mejor que sea pequeño y tenga pocos sapos, right? So to better know a pond, it's better that the pond is small and populated by just few frogs, right? And this is exactly what the low surface brightness field is or was, at least some years ago. Few people really work on this field, and that allows to really focus on interesting things without too many bias or cosmic forces that force you to do something or another thing, because, for example, fashion in astronomy is also important, and many people was doing the same, right? So this was or is still today a very interesting field from that point of view. So this is the bell of the... So some definitions, very quickly. What is a LSB galaxy? In few words, is, I don't know what this bell is ringing every time. An LSB galaxy is, in pure and simple explanations, is a galaxy with a surface brightness fainter than the night sky, which is about 22 a magnitude per square second in the B band, right? This is, as many of you know, is biased by the definition of this by Kenny in the 70s, right? So this magnitude is the limit in which you really can detect objects in the sky in general, right? Fainter than this, you have to really do much more effort with the instruments and the exposure times and many other things to is more observational limit than an instrumental thing. So the simple definition, which is above, carry also many other consequences that has been studied in the last 20 years. And many of them has been especially interesting because the hidden doubts and other open questions that still turn around, right? Some of them are this. So they have low stellar formation rates, which is perhaps due to a lack or even deficit of low molecular gas of molecular gas density. They have also large H1 fractions, which is something that many people was interested also in the 90s. Well, Hector Bravo is here here in the talk. Perhaps he has many things to do and to say about this. They have large H1 fractions in general. They present very flat and extended rotation curves. This is a reflect of perhaps that they have a lot of fractions of dark matter. They have also high specific angular momentum, something that have been studied in the last years with much more emphasis, I would say. They also appear to be much more relatively isolated in the cosmic web. Okay, they do not populate very dense environments in principle in the cosmic web. However, as I said before, the ultra-diffuse galaxies appear to be populating many clusters, in particular, for example, the Coma, Virgo, and I will present some results about the Fornax cluster too, right? So this is something that is, of course, shaking a little bit the environment of LSB community. Today I will focus mainly on this question that are in orange. Okay, I will not discuss everything of a big laundry list of questions. I will just focus on some of these that I think are questions that are more key to understand better this kind of population. So this is a list that is highly biased by personal interest, right? So which is the relevance of LSBs in few words? They dominate the volume density of galaxies. So here you see a very old paper, a figure on an old paper by O'Neill and Botton. So O'Neill is one of the people that escaped this field, apparently in the 2005 or 6. She decided to left a little bit this field, which is really a shame because it's sad because she's a very competent and excellent researcher, but apparently she decided not to continue in this field. So this is a figure showed by O'Neill and Botton in a paper in 2000, where you clearly see how these very faint galaxies in subtle brightness dominate the volume density, right? Nobody knows exactly how this line continues for fainter subtle brightness, right? This is the Freeman law that was defined by the apparent limit given by a physical law that was in fact not a law, but at that time was regarded like a law, that a spiral galaxy, the disk of spiral galaxies, seems to disappear. I mean, galaxies do not have a faint disk fainter than 21.65, which is, we know very clearly now that it's not the case. That was just a bias introduced by the photographic plates, right? Some of you, especially students, can see this paper, which is a very nice example of how you can arrive to wrong conclusions because of observational bias, by the way, this paper of 1970. Okay. Here you have a luminosity function, stellar mass luminosity function given by many galaxies, right? This is the typical shape you probably is very familiar to you, the luminosity function written in terms of mass, right? So this is the typical thing you can see in survey telescopes, in surveys made by optical telescope, where the apparent magnitude limit is quite high, say 21, 22, or something like that. Or even if it's fainter, you are not sensitive to the sky brightness, to the surface brightness of the objects. If you go deeper, that means to smaller masses, you can really reveal the very universe of low surface brightness galaxies and low masses, right? Because finally, the low surface brightness is a reflex of the low stellar mass density, right? So here you can see this is a survey, the Wave Area Vista Extragalactic Survey, the WAVE survey, which is part of the Foremost Consortium. And here you can see how they are completing what is happening at very, very low masses, right? Most of these objects, all of them, almost, are also very low surface brightness objects, right? Okay. Here you can see also in this work by Muñoz in 2015 with the Next Generation Foreign Survey, NGFSS, leading by Thomas Putzi at Católica. Here you can see very spectacularly how the there is a tight relation between the effective radius of objects. In this case, most of them are galaxies, but here you can see also globular clusters, and you can see the surface brightness, right, which is related, we will see, with the stellar mass density, right, with many objects. These are the objects from the survey, right, and here you can see the dwarfs that are nucleated. Most of these are dwarfs in the Forna cluster. You can see the nucleated dwarfs, which we have been paying special attention in this survey, and here you can see the lines of fixed surface brightness, and you can see that all this NGFS insensitive region is, of course, the very region that is very interesting today to see how the galaxies or objects populate here. The ultra diffuse galaxies are around here, right? In this point, in this area. In this survey, there are few ultra diffuse galaxies, but on the other hand, there are a lot of very diffuse galaxies, very faint, low surface brightness galaxies, fainter than 24, 26, which are very faint either, right? And here you can see how the different populations separate. What really makes the galaxies to fall in one of these regions, of course, is completely unknown today. Something happened in the galactic evolution that makes the galaxy, when they form, that they finish here, here, or here, right? Here you can see the typical grand design galaxies in these gray squares, right? Okay. Here you can see another plot from the same survey, a more recent plot by Eigenthaler and company on the same survey. And here you can see the lines of equal surface mass density in solar masses per square parsec, right? And here you can see, of course, that This plot also reveals the different galaxy populations very clearly, right? And how these galaxies or objects, more precisely speaking, are separated in this kind of diagrams. Here you can see the globular clusters, the faint dwarfs, normal galaxies, and here seems to be some sort of green valley, right? In this kind of diagram. Mm. You can see this publication is quite interesting. So as I mentioned before, the surface brightness encodes the surface mass density, which is something that finally is a benchmark in a galaxy that perhaps is telling us the past history, right? Okay, some examples of LSBs. There are many, many examples, different flavors, colors, sizes, of course. So you will see. So this has been collected by Makov in the 94. At that time, still people exploited the photographic plates because one of the special things of these galaxies is that if you see a special region in the sky, a small part, you will not detect too many of them. There are many, but yet they are absolutely spread about the cosmic volume. So you really need very big field of views. For example, the work by Bindokum 2015, where they rediscovered the ultra-diffuse galaxies, they really use a very big field instrument, this Dragonfly camera, that allows really to test and to prove to probe the big sky. So at that time in 1994, there were not this kind of instruments. They have to rely on photographic plates, and what they have is these kind of things, terrible things. Imagine how do you really obtain valuable information from this? It's very complicated, but it was the first step. So now, for example, PAWA in 2018 collected a lot of these galaxies from the Sloan, which is not a survey that has been designed to discover these galaxies. So you are really proving the last tail of the survey are really loads of brightness galaxies. Of course, you have more, a lot, because it's a very big survey, but the fraction of these galaxies is small in this survey compared to others, because the survey has not been designed for this. But any case, and it's in this same work, you can see a very interesting thing is that galaxies, of course, the LSB galaxies seems to be dominated by this galaxy than Belch, typical Belch plus these galaxies. Something that is interesting and, of course, makes a lot of questions in the community, right? Okay. Here you have more examples of LSBs for the people who's not working in this field. This is the typical example of the NGFS survey in Fornax. Most of them are dwarf galaxies. Some of them exhibit nucleus. Here you can see nucleus of these galaxies, a central core. And we are studying what is the central core in these galaxies. Perhaps are clusters of stars, very dense central clusters, which is something that we are investigating. And so you can find here you have the galaxies, and here you have the fit with Galfit. And here you can see the many, many figures you have. They are very diffuse things. For example, this FCC 245 here, where the cursor is pointed, is very diffuse. Some of these are very, very difficult to discover, right? Okay. Well, another examples, as I said you before, many of these galaxies came in different sizes and flavors. And talking about sizes, you have really, really a big spectrum of galaxies. This is Malin 1. This is one of the biggest galaxies in discovered so far, in fact. It's a big spiral. The big question here is if you have more of these galaxies, of course. Here is an image from the HST in 2000 of Malin 1. The spiral arms are very difficult to see. In fact, we published a paper in 2015 where we really show that the spiral arms of these galaxies are very peculiar and very big, right? And apparently what happened is that many people work in this field, when they see the images of O'Neill in 2000 when the HST and the spiral arms were not there, maybe people think that the spiral arms were much more fainter and very difficult to observe. And in 2015, we in fact redo observations from the south. This galaxy is mostly observable in the north, but we just catch a good season to observe this galaxy in the south with Magellan. And we observe that in fact the galaxy is very populated by big, big spiral arms, right? And in fact, the size of the galaxy is about 200 kiloparsec diameter. So we are talking about a galaxy which is 5 to 6 times bigger than the Milky Way, right? This is an image from Magellan. And at the same time, almost at the same time, 1 year after, Samuel Boissier published another paper on the study with the CFHT, and they also observed the big spiral arms. Well, just two publications almost colliding. So we published just some few months before, right? Well, this is a very special case of LSB galaxy because it's almost, it's really a mystery because it's a big galaxy. Perhaps it has a lot of dark matter to be stable in the rotation. There is up to now no molecular gas detected, right? I will show some recent results, negative detections, but still very, very sensitive, as you will see.
I'm sorry, can I interrupt you?
Yes.
I was just wondering how, what is the M over L, so the ratio, because you mentioned that it's very dark matter dominated.
It's high, it's more than, I think it's near 1,000 or something like that.
Okay.
I don't have the number in mind. I should have it. I confess.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
But it's very high. Yes. Mm-hmm. The other thing is this galaxy is dominated by the mass of the H1. In terms of baryonic mass, the H1 is huge. It's about 10^10 solar masses.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask a question too?
Yeah. Okay.
You said that there's like 200. It's much larger than our galaxy, but how large do we? How large is our galaxy really? Couldn't there be really low surface brightness arms very far out?
Yeah. Well, I will comment that after, because the things you see here, I don't know if you notice, there are some strange features here. One here and one here, right? This is a galaxy that is behind Malin 1, and this is perhaps some stellar or whatever tail, which is connected with another galaxy, which is much far away, 300 kiloparsecs away, which has the same redshift of Malin 1 that has been noted by other researchers, Rashidnikov and others, and it's still not clear if this is a merging remain, right? So, okay. It's And if you go deeper, even deeper, we reach 28 magnitudes per square second here. So you have to reach perhaps 31 magnitudes per square second to reveal the very extension of these spiral arms, but it's not clear yet. We had more time in VLT in March, but the observing time was canceled because of the COVID. So I would like very much to answer your question, but I'm not able to do that.
Yeah, I'm afraid maybe you didn't quite understand my question. My question was about our galaxy, the Milky Way galaxy. Does the Milky Way galaxy? Yeah.
Sorry.
Does the Milky Way galaxy, is it extra large? It could have, you know, very low surface brightness arms that we don't see.
Sure. Of course. Yeah. Of course. But what is true that is our galaxy has more and more satellites that are discovered year by year, or well, every 5 years there are another very faint satellite that is discovered in our galaxy. And also you have the Magellanic Stream, that is a very faint stream of H1 that connects the Magellanic Cloud with our galaxy. Who knows what happened with the stellar streams connected to that, of course. Yeah. Yes. Okay, where's the gas of the galaxy? It's not clear. How is the gas? Which is the temperature? Which is the density? It's not clear. Where is the Malin 1 located in the Krumholtz diagram, which is a very good diagram to understand the stellar formation and the time scale of the stellar formation in terms of the gas density? It's not clear too, right? That's why it's very important to measure the gas density in this kind of galaxies, right? Okay. Yes. So this is the image by Boissier in 2016. As you can see, it's very similar to our data. Okay, this scale is 31 kiloparsecs. This is 20. Oh my goodness. Sorry, my phone. Okay, this is really a very big galaxy. So I asked the people who is writing something in my slides to not to do that, please. There are some things that appear here. So Boissier suggests in 2016 that after looking comparing models with there's some regions that they detected emission lines. In a couple of regions, they detected emission lines in this galaxy. They compare model with the stellar formation rates, And they conclude that there is no many differences between this galaxy and with the Milky Way, except that this galaxy has around 20 times larger angular momentum, right? I will refer to this point later in this talk. But the other things is that apparently it's a galaxy that has been formed a lot of stars in the past very quickly, and then the stellar formation has been stopped, right? It's just passively evolving. It's not something that could be regarding that a galaxy that has been very efficient to form stars and then is quiet, right? Or the initial amount of gas was not so high and then you have low stars, but there are problems with this because Malling 1 seems to be a galaxy, seems to be two galaxies. One is the disk that is very low density, and then you have in the center something that appeared to be a galaxy, a quite normal galaxy with a high super brightness, right? So there are a lot of questions here that are not really answered. Okay.
Sorry, I interrupt you again. So there's a galaxy within it. You said that.
Yes, I say that. It's like to that, right? It's not that you have really two galaxies, but when you see the populations of Malling 1, you rapidly arrive to the conclusion that the central part of the galaxy seems to be a galaxy itself, right? And then the spiral arms seems to be completely detached in the sense that you really see a change in color, say, change in kinematics.
And what kind is, like, kind of elliptical or spheroidal? Because it could it be like a fluffy cluster of stars or something like that?
No, it's a big one. No, it seems to be a spiral grand design galaxy in the center.
Okay.
Right, no, it's not like to say this is a small thing. No, this is big. You can look the scale. This is 30 kiloparsecs, right? So it's not something. But the central part, as I indicated here, seems to be a different galaxy.
I meant by Aaron et al.
In 2010, and where he discussed it. Right.
Yeah, so I was meaning the central galaxy, no? Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. You're welcome. So okay. So I was mentioning the Krumholtz diagram, which is important to study this. In fact, every galaxy, or not every galaxy, but if you populate this diagram, this is the Krumholtz diagram with many galaxies, you see that there is a tight relation between the gas density, the gas surface density, in fact, is solar masses per square parsec, between that and the efficiency of stellar formation rate, right? Here you see the solar masses formed by year and by kiloparsec square. So if you plot this diagram, you see that this has a tight relation, okay? But apparently this relation seems to be broke at low gas density, right? Here you have the spirals. The higher the surface brightness, more linearly seems to behave the galaxies in this diagram. And when you start to arrive to very low surface density in the gas, which is forming stars, the seems to be broken here. So the surface brightness, the low surface brightness, the galaxy seems to populate this region, this very low region, where the physical conditions of the gas, where they form stars, seems to be a little bit different. Perhaps it's a conversion factor to when you can compute from the CO, for example, you compute the amount of molecular gas, H2, which cannot be observed directly. Perhaps the conversion factor is not the same in high surface brightness galaxies than in LSBs, right? So it's not completely clear what you are, how these LSB galaxies populate this part of the diagram, which finally reflect the fact that we do not understand how the LSBs form stars in the past, right? So this is the area where LSBs should be, okay? There are many questions. Also important to note in this personally biased things that has to be focused is the dynamical time evolution in terms of the gas, right? Stellar formation rate, okay? This is a plot by Daddy in 2010, when you can see that also spirals and other kind of galaxies are separated in this plot and seems to be part of the sequence, okay, which can be understood by simple physics. This is not complicated. And LSBs also seems to be here, but up to now, nobody knows really what's happening. And what is why this is important is because the LSBs, okay, as was noted in 97, are probably the largest dynamical time and are well separated from the other populations, right? It seems to be that the dynamical times of these galaxies, given that they have low surface brightness and low stellar masses, the dynamical time is very large, right? And that has a direct impact in the stellar formation rate. Okay, that is something that perhaps is very interesting to be pay attention, right? So the lack of molecular gas is because of they really don't have gas, of they have gas, but the physical conditions preclude the stellar formation is one key question. Okay, so there has been many efforts to detect the molecular gas. Most of them, of course, as usual, via the CO detection, which is very dangerous, by the way, because the entire community looking for stellar formation rates in galaxies and to study molecular gas use this gas, which of course is quite good because it's a good tracer of H2. There are many studies in the past revealing this this tight relation. But when you really go to domains in gas density, it's not clear that this is the best way to detect the gas that is there, not forming stars, but at the level that perhaps they are up to almost forming stars, at the limit of the genes, for example, at the genes mass or genes temperature to form stars, which is perhaps what is happening in these galaxies. Okay. So the first detection of the CO in one of these galaxies was by O'Neill in 2000, but in an obscure, very untraceable LSP in the terms is not a big and very well-known galaxy you can see in our neighborhood. Was a galaxy situated at almost 0.08 or 0.1 in redshift. At the time where many people was looking for CO in LSB's galaxies in our immediate neighborhood in the extragalactic space, right? So then Matthew in 2001, they also discovered more molecular gas in another LSB galaxy, okay? But in Malin 1, which is not closer, this galaxy is at 0.08 in redshift, it's not very close. But it's very big, and of course, it's a very interesting target for CO detection. And despite many efforts that has been done more than 20 years ago, nobody so far has detected molecular gas. This was one of these pioneering studies by Brain et al. In 2000, and they do not detect molecular gas using IRAM and other ancillary telescopes. Here you can see the H1 distribution in this diagram in the right. You can see that the H1 is really large, right? These are the pointings for the search of CO by Brain. They do not detect CO. And another thing that happened, and this is some anecdotic thing to tell, is in that paper in 2000, he recognized that many people in the community at that time has observed another galaxy which is very close to Malin 1, and it's a big design spiral galaxy, but it's not Malin 1. And many of the observations were in fact flying to the trash because was not the galaxy that many people wanted to study. Another errors that the people has committed, for example, they were not calibrated well, the spectrograph in the correct velocity, etc. Many, many things that by some mysterious reason didn't allow the people to study this galaxy at that time. Okay. Then Brain, the same, here you can see the signal. Okay. They arrived to 5 to 4 millikelvin, and they didn't detect the gas. This was using IRAM, right? So one of the thing that Brain comment in the paper is that he think, or they think, that the CO could be colder than expected. That he made a lot of explanation why the gas should or could be cold in this galaxy, the molecular gas. And if this is the case, this will reduce the CO emission per mass of H2, okay? And if combined with the metallicity effects that are usually these galaxies present low metallicity, could explain why at that time the people didn't detect CO yet. Okay, so still today, efforts continue. We have made this kind of efforts using the Green Bank Telescope, Argus. This is a detector which is some sort of a poor man interferometric instrument, right? This is a detector with many horns that detect CO, and then you can make some sort of mapping, right? It's a very good instrument, but of course it's mounted in GVT, which has not the best atmospheric and location qualities for this kind of CO observation at millimeter wavelengths. So of course we observe a lot of hours. I will lost in the how many hours, but more than 50 hours observing this galaxy, and this is the result. We reach about 3 millikelvin, okay, and again, no detection in the galaxy of CO. This was made in last year, so bad news, but anyway, okay. So no detection up to the 3 sigma level, okay. We are thinking to change the observing technique, perhaps looking for other lines, but CO lines of higher orders are probably even more difficult to detect, right? So it's still not clear what we are going to do with this. So one of the questions that arise here is if the ISM is really colder, right? As Brain claim, we think that perhaps this is not the case, and on the other hand, it's completely the contrary, right? Perhaps the ISM is hotter, right? It's warmer, and in that case, why? Because you have less metallicity, so less dust. So the ISM is more transparent to UV radiation. And then perhaps the few molecular gas you can see in this galaxy is in fact warmer because of this UV radiation that reaches larger distances because you don't have too much dust for shielding. And then perhaps the gas is warmer. This is something that we have discussed in a publication in 2008. But it's still not clear. It's a little crazy idea, and it's something that should be better understood. Okay, so we need for other lines, we need for more observations. This is something that many people conclude here. Okay, it is not clear. Okay, another thing that is interesting to pay attention is about the specific angular momentum, and as I previously commented, okay, the angular momentum is encoding many information in the galaxies, okay? Results from several authors indicate that the angular momentum and the specific angular momentum, the angular momentum per solar mass is higher than in other galaxies, specifically high sulfur brownish galaxies, okay? Why is like that? Nobody really knows, okay? What is behind that is not clear.
Excuse me?
Yes.
Hello? Yeah, sorry, yes. I couldn't mention this earlier. I had to step out. But about your molecular gas, your search for molecular gas, there are definitely other things you can do. You could do, for example, search for OH. That traces molecular gas. Another thing you can do is use continuum observations, submillimeter continuum observations, and H1 observations, H1 21 centimeter. And comparing those can tell you if there's an excess due to molecular gas. Just couple yes. of ideas.
You are completely right, and in fact we present twice proposal to ALMA, in fact, and they were rejected, and then they were accepted, and they were not observed because they were in band three in all the rank they do for proposals. So we have presented that, yes of course. But it's not easy. And another thing is very good your question, because of course it's not that it's too mysterious. Of course we can do all of that, But it's not easy to have observing time for these galaxies, right? When you present a proposal where you want to observe one galaxy, right, and you need, say, 30 hours or more to be sure, because all the other observations reveal no data, they really hesitate, right? They really hesitate to give you time. And that's what the people were escaping from this field in the 90s, right? As I commented, because it's really difficult. We can talk about that in the questions if you want. Okay, so thanks for the intervention. So here you have results from fall in 2018, where you can see that the models, in fact, predict that LSP galaxies, or more specifically, galaxies having low stellar mass, have a lower angular momentum, right? What is behind that? It's not clear, as I said. Why this could be a key for understand the evolution of LSP galaxies? Okay, is because, as were shown by Fall in 1983, in fact, the specific angular momentum is related to the mass, the stellar mass, with a very tight relation, as you can see in these plots, right? And the normalization, on the other hand, depends on morphology or the kind of galaxy you are studying. The morphology is also related to angular momentum, because ellipticals have a distribution in angular momentum that is completely different than what you see in spiral galaxies, which have a disk. Okay. So the scaling relation, when you consider this, evolves as 1 plus c, like this. Okay. So in fact, the evolution of the angular momentum from the back time to now is interesting too. Okay, you can see this publication, by the way, this publication by Rensin is very interesting. You can see that when he wrote this, it's like he has all the time for discuss everything. Okay, it's a publication just by him. It's a very qualitative publication, but with very interesting ideas. So I really recommend to read this. This paper by Rensin in 2020. Okay. These are results by Perez Montaño and Cervantes that are here in this talk. Okay, where they really they clearly show that the angular momentum also they use simulations by Illustris, and in these simulations it's clearly apparent that the angular momentum of LSBs in average is larger than in normal HSB galaxies, right? There are other simulations I will show you made in this year that show the same. Okay, so we are also studying this kind of things. I am working with a student now that is trying to make a compilation of all we know about the angular momentum of spiral galaxies, not only LSBs, and try to understand why these galaxies, LSB galaxies, seem to be different. Okay, this is just in preparation today, at this time. Okay, another thing that is important is land release that I've been selected for you today. Is the question is that why LSBs seems to be isolated in the cosmic wave? This is also another thing that has been studied by many people from the 20s. Okay. In the 2000s, sorry. And that has been reported by several authors. One of the first ones was Song in 2010. Then with Laura Ceccarelli, we published another paper in 2012 about this. And LSB galaxy seems to be at the end of the filamentary structure of the universe, right? Why it's like that is not clear at all, okay? So simulations now are very valuable tools to understand better this behavior, right? So in particular, Illustris, the next generation, and Eagle are very useful for this. Su et al. In 2018 was one of the first to adventure in these simulations to understand the formation and evolution of LSB galaxies. Okay, and here you can see one of the plots, right? It's that typical Python plot, okay, where you see what they discover. they make a simulation in which they take one of these galaxies, which resembles very much Malin 1, and they discover in the simulation that this galaxy was formed by the collision of three galaxies, not two, but three galaxies. One, if I understood, was an elliptical one, and then the two collide and a spiral galaxy form. These are the redshifts where you can, of the trajectory of the galaxies. There you have the two intruders, that was the name he gave to the thing, two intruders, colliding with the central galaxy. And then very rapidly, the gas redistribute with the stars, and then you have another kind of galaxy, which is very similar to Malin 1. So here you can see this is the great thing of simulations. You can see the distribution of the matter in the galaxy in different axes. Here you have the C axis. So you see in violet and red, you see the gas, and the rest are stars. And then you see the gas evolving as a function of the galaxocentric distance. So you see that there are clumps of stellar formation around the disk, etc. Right? It's very interesting. You can see this is a very good thing. Okay. And here you see the evolution in redshift, of course. This is the great thing of simulations. You can see how after the collision is about in C.5, okay, and then the gas still transfer angular momentum, and then you have after C.2, you have really a big design LSP galaxy. It's very interesting. Here you see the loopback time as a function of the temperature of the cold gas. Okay, they define the cold gas. They have a lot of recipes, etc. I will not comment on that, but they have the evolution of the temperature of the gas, and this is very important because you see that the gas is first after collisions is quite hot in average. The typical gas you found in a spiral galaxy is around 10 to 3 to 5 Kelvin, right? If I'm not wrong, in the galaxy. Here you see how the gas increase the temperature, right, very violently in the loopback time, and then the gas stabilize and then decrease in temperature, right? So this is the kind of things you can see in the simulations. Now we have with our collaborators, Andrea Coulier and company. Andrea was a postdoc at the Instituto of Astrofísica at Católica. She lives for Leiden some months ago, just before the pandemic. It was very good decision, I think. And with Andrea, we use a hydrodynamical model. In this case, it's Eagle, okay, which is in principle is different than Illustris. Illustris is mostly a semi-analytic model. Eagle is a complete hydrodynamical model. Okay, it uses also some recipes from observations, but it's mostly an hydrodynamical model. Well, you can really, for first principles, you can see galaxies evolve and form whatever you see in the universe. And here we discovered that there are many galaxies formed in this simulation that are quite similar to Malin 1, not as large, but still quite large. I mean, I'm talking about 100 and 95 kiloparsec diameter, some big things. And it's not the only one. There are many, many of these. Okay, many. When I say many, I say something between 10 and 20, not hundreds or thousands, but a considerable number. Okay, in the case of Sue, they discovered just one, where they studied, right? So with Eagle, we were also able to understand, for example, the angular momentum, the specific angular momentum, and we see how they evolve as a function of the not evolving, in fact, how they distributed and as a function of the stellar mass of the galaxies. And also we see as Pérez Montaño that the LSP seems to have a larger angular momentum compared to high surface brightness galaxies, right? Here you can see the cut for 25 magnitude square second. There are many of the properties that we see. I will not enter into detail. This is a very technical part. For example, here you can see also other things that has not been commented in other literature, that it seems to be a tight relation between the orbital circularity parameter, which has been defined by Abadi in 2003, with these galaxies and HSB galaxies. This parameter, which is defined like this, is in fact is the projection of the angular momentum to the C axis of the disk, right? So when a galaxy is very spiral, very disky, these terms seem to be closer to one, right? And when you have a very ellipsoid galaxy, elliptical galaxy, you have an E star that is close to zero, right? It's a measure of the scatter you see in the stellar kinematics. It's mostly that. Okay, it's a measure of the disk you have. How disky is the galaxy? Sorry. We also discovered some relations. For example, Andrea invented a very interesting parameter that is this FXC2 that that measure the degree of isolation the galaxy have when the most of the stars were formed, right? For example, a galaxy that has a FXC2 less than 0.1 are galaxies that are formed mostly inside a rich group of galaxies, an environment that is very populated by all the galaxies. And on the contrary, a galaxy that has a FXC2 larger than 0.5 is a galaxy that evolves mostly isolated, right? Just to be very brief in the explanation. So here you see that galaxies that are mostly formed FXC2 are galaxies that seems to be isolated, right? And that is the thing. And so we are studying this in terms of LSBs, and it's not completely clear, but we have to focus more on this. This has been published just recently in May. Okay, so now conclusions. This is all I wanted to talk to you. LSBs seems to be fundamental pieces of extragalactic universe because they dominate the volume density, okay, as I shown before. And yet the formation evolution is not completely understood. There is a lot of questions in this sea of apparent ignorance. Okay. One of the things that are still not well understood are the physical properties of the ISM, where the stars were formed in these galaxies. Okay. A key element to understand this seems to be the angular momentum, specifically talking the specific angular momentum of LSBs, and to compare the evolution of this quantity between HSPs and LSBs seems to be key. Okay. The angular momentum seems to encode the past evolution of these galaxies. Another thing is that current models are turning to be very useful tools to understand the evolution and formation evolution of these galaxies, and seems to be able to reproduce many of the observables of these galaxies. Okay. Another thing that is key to understand and to be linked to the evolution of galaxies in general is the role of dark matter, of course. As you realize, I didn't mention too much or even almost nothing about dark matter in LSBs, but it's a very, very fundamental piece of study here. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Gaspar. Well, there was another conclusion there left. Okay, so we have time for a few questions. Not too much time because this is Sundar's account, and I think he needs it for something in 15 minutes or so. There are too many questions. We don't have time for that many questions. But okay, I will start with Rosa.
Oh, hi! Very nice talk, Gaspar. Thank you.
Thanks to you.
So in your models, in your simulations, the galaxies do have molecular gas, right?
Yes. Sorry.
So I hope you can detect it because being objects that are so extreme, but at the same time so abundant, although we cannot see them, they would illuminate a lot. For example, I don't think that the Krumholz diagram is very illuminating. I think that the two axes are not independent to see it. So it would be very illuminating to understand many things about star formation. Thank you.
Thanks to you. Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with you. Of course, the Krumholtz diagram is something that well, this came from Kennicott, many in 98, right, something like that, and it's a very useful tool to understand many things. But I agree. I mean, perhaps the Krumholtz diagram is not the best way to understand many things in these galaxies. And the other thing, by the way, is that the Krumholtz diagram has been used for many studies, but unfortunately, many people melt H2 with H1 in this. Sorry, H2 with H1. I mean, the molecular gas and an atomic gas in the diagrams. And it's not completely clear what is the link between the two. They just sum up all the gas and put everything they have. And it's completely, I mean, unclear where, if you can see, you can do that. Okay, so yeah, there are many. Yeah, the Krumholtz diagram can be very useful, but also can be a very dangerous tool if you are not taking care about the interpretation of the results. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay.
I think Hector Bravo has a question.
Hola, soy Hector. ¿Sí me escuchan?
Hola Hector.
Hi, Gaspar. Let me ask this in English. A quick hello. But I will switch off the camera because I was not in a decent fashion. Gaspar, this is a very naive question. I'm not an expert of the field. But have you ever found a possible difference between the LSB galaxies, which populate a low density environment, and those many which have been found in clusters? Because it seems that in Coma, for example, as far as I remember, some of them are really kind of dwarf galaxies, which could lose the gas at an early stage of the evolution, while those isolated might be really huge ones. But I don't know if you could really split the population. Do you have any information about this?
Thanks, Hector. Yeah, this is a very good question. And of course, it's something that is turning around many people working in this field. Let me say something about the history of the rediscovering of ultra-diffuse galaxies by Van Dokkum. When you see the publication of Van Dokkum in 2015, the title of the publication is something like ultra-diffuse galaxies of the size of the Milky Way, right? And this is very important because it tells you something about the collective imaginary or whatever you can say that about when you see this kind of title. After, I would say, 2 weeks or 1 week after this publication, 99% of the community in astronomy found this is incredible. This is an incredible discovery because half of the number of these galaxies discovered by Van Dokkum are of the size of the Milky Way and have surface brightness of about 28, 29, 26, right? Okay, why? Because he determined that because the effective radius of these LSD galaxies discovered by Van Dokkum are of the same kind, on the same level, I mean, the same scale of the Milky Way. But the effective radius could be very dangerous because the effective radius of our Milky Way is about 10 kiloparsecs, right? Something like that, if I'm not wrong. But doesn't mean that the size of the Milky Way is 10 kiloparsecs. It's much more than that, okay? And then these galaxies, in fact, are small, are not of the size of the Milky Way. And this is something that's been discussing the community the last 2 years, and they have some fights even between people about this. And these are not large galaxies, first of all, and most of them are devoid of gas. Most of them. It's like the galaxies we see in the Fornax cluster that I showed in the beginning of the talk. Most of them are small, are faint galaxies, of course, very low superbrightness, but they don't have gas. This is something that we wanted to do with ALMA. Now, but of course, with the pandemic, we lost observing time too. So, To answer your question, this is a key thing, of course. Probably most of the galaxies in these clusters are devoid of gas because, as you say, there are merging and harassment episodes that make these galaxies be devoid of gas. So it's an open question, of course, but seems to be completely different. The origin of these galaxies in these clusters seems to be completely different than the origin of galaxies like Malin 1. Okay. The only thing perhaps they have in common is they have low solar brightness, but not the origin, right? Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Gaspar.
Welcome. Okay, and maybe one last final question from Veronica.
Hi. So I don't know, if someone wants to ask, I can give the there's someone else. I can write to you later because I don't want to take a lot of time.
No, it's fine. We just have to leave by 1:10 or something. So okay. We have 5 minutes.
So then I go. I mean, I think that you are totally right about not talking about dark matter in this case. It's like, it blows my mind because it's something that it's not just like dark matter dominated, but it's like M over L. I mean, the ratio is so big. So I'm really surprised. So I was just thinking, I don't know if you, I mean, you were saying some things about the position in the cosmic web of this kind of galaxies, right? And you were also saying something about the, I don't know if I got it correct, about the star formation history, or that was something that happened really, really fast in the formation of stars. I don't know if I'm correct. Maybe I misunderstood that part. But I was thinking, I mean, it must be all the baryonic part and the star formation really related to the dark matter halo. So I was thinking if it could be a case, since you were going through the simulations and all that stuff, if it's a case where the dark matter halo is growing very fast in some time. I mean, it's just growing very fast. And that could, you know, could cause these rapid star formation episodes or something like that. I don't know. But I don't know. It's just naive.
Yeah, well, thank you for the question. The thing is, well, the publication by Andrea Coulier, I have to confess, is very dense. There are many, many things that she really did an impressive job. I really recommend to read that if you are interested in these kind of things.
Yeah.
But what she revealed, in fact, is that there are a lot of, a lot of observables you see after the time evolution of these galaxies that are connected, right? There are connections between the angular momentum and the environment where the galaxies are formed. There are connections between the dark matter halos, as you correctly say, and what you observe baryonic matter after.
Sorry, and I must say that also the shape of the dark matter halos, because low surface brightness galaxies, they are like more cored, right? There's a property that they have. So I was wondering, with these huge galaxies, how's the shape of the halo?
Yeah, no, it's not clear. No. In the simulations that Andrea did, because I'm not expert in simulations, as you realize, it's not clear. I mean, there are many things that when you see that publication, there are many things that are great. For example, there is a relationship between the stellar formation rates in the core of the galaxy and the outskirts. See figure, I think it's figure 8. The paper, and then you see that there are things that are completely new in the sense that you see different star formations in the outskirts of the galaxy when the galaxy is near a higher density environment than when the galaxy is in a low density environment, right? Things like that nobody has revealed before. One of the plots I show you is about that, but perhaps I didn't explain it very well because of the time and my limitations to be more executive in this kind of things. But I really recommend you to see that paper because there are many, many details, many details in the explanation of the things, right?
Thank you.
They're very specific to technical things. So I remember, I, I, I recommend you to see that paper.
Yeah, thank you.
I will send you the link, Baron. I have that paper, so
thank you.
Sorry to cut this a bit short, but it was a very interesting discussion. But this is not my Zoom account, so I need to return it. But yeah, let's thank Gaspar again for a great presentation. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Vicente, and all of you for the patience.
No, it was a pleasure. Okay, so I will end this. Bye, everybody.
Okay,
bye. Thanks. Thank you, Gaspar.
Hi, bye.
Nice to see you.
Chao, Héctor. Gusto hablar contigo.
Hasta luego, Gaspar.
Me alegro que estés bien. Chao.